this was, for some reason, ended up in Friday's business section, perhaps because people assumed that it was about embossing. It must be in the business section. But this paper's really for the benefit of artists, because I think it's for artists that it might be a useful technique. It addresses some of the problems that we've already heard about, like longevity of the image. And it's basically a paper where I've tried to put down everything I can remember from the notes I took at the time of what we did at C3. Nigel Abraham was a very important part of that. I thought he might actually be here, but I don't think he has turned up. And it's the... What you'll see here is really a slideshow in support of the paper. All the nitty-gritty is in the paper, which I'm embarrassed to say some of you have been forced to purchase as a separate component, although I think you have it on the CD-ROM as part of the symposium fee. So I'm just going to review the historical sort of aspect of C3 and how it started, and why the secret was a secret, and why it might be useful to artists in the future. The first thing you might say is, well, why haven't you given this paper a long time ago? And I discussed with Jonathan when we were selling C3 holograms whether we should let the cat out of the bag, and we thought it probably wouldn't be appropriate at that time. And pretty quickly, AGFA stopped making the emulsions we were using, so it would seem a bit of a tease to tell you how to use AGFA emulsions, which didn't exist anymore, to master embossed holograms. Now, with the new Fuji emulsion, there's a huge new possibility of resurrecting this sort of work and taking it from what we did and looking again at the chemistry and perhaps really using it afresh. So the story begins with Jeff Blythe and myself still at Cambridge University teaching and writing a book, and Jeff introducing me to holography and in a way seducing me into a completely different life. We were making... Can I get the mouse to work? No, I can't. Little space shuttle holograms like that one, which were it was a cottage industry contact copy method, and we tried to make a business of it. I seem to remember working for a whole year and not getting paid in that interim, but it was jolly good fun. And every 2 weeks we would or so we'd drive down to London to sell our wares to the only shop that seemed to be buying them, was called Parallax in Covent Garden, run by somebody we knew as Hamish Goodwill, and he would buy up all we could make. And one day I saw a totally new sort of hologram that had just been brought over from the United States of America, and I said, Jeff, that's amazing, it's got all these rainbow colours in it, it's fantastic, why aren't we doing those? He just said, it's a different sort of hologram, don't bother about it. And I said, but it's on plastic, it's got to be really cheap. And so I bought one of the Skull and Rocks and took it back to our little studio in Shelford and sort of started to get the glue off it, because it was obviously some kind of impression. And Jeff suggested, if I was that bothered about it, why didn't I phone up somebody at the Pat Center? And they were doing 14-inch discs, which were the sort of grandfathers of the CD-ROM. And they had massive, great lab with huge laser. Millions of pounds, by the look of it, had been spent creating their facility. So I phoned them up and said, why don't we make a rainbow hologram and work together? And whilst I was making that arrangement, one of our other clients who were buying our little silver halide holograms, Nigel at C3, said, oh, if you're making a rainbow hologram, you'll need me on board, and I can help you because you can make the laser transmission with me at a studio in Lotts Road, which I didn't realize at the time was owned by Ken Harris, and he had an arrangement to use it. And so we made the H1 in London and took it up to Royston and made the H2. And as far as I'm aware, that is the first photoresist hologram made outside the USA. And it was of a little model that I'd made in plasticine and coated with superglue to keep it still, and put a ping pong ball, in front of it as a sort of globe. Now, if you know about stereophotography and you know how to free view, I think this is far enough so that if you visually drag those two yellow dots together, you should be able to fuse the image by parallel viewing and see a 3D image. Only people probably who have practiced at doing it will be successful, but it should be possible. I tried to work out the distance of the throw to make that doable. And that's the image of the very first photoresist hologram that we made together, Nigel, the technicians at Pat Center. And although Lawrence Holden, Nick Phillips were working on trying to do the same, I think the embossed hologram had an impact on all of us. I believe spring 1981 makes that the first thing, though it wasn't mass produced. We then decided that we would like to build a studio. We wasted time in Sunningdale on working on other projects, which were a bit of a distraction, but came up with things like this silver halide ship, which was one of the subjects we used in our trials to make silver halide masters. We gave up and raised some money and then made a lab in London. And these stereophotos, Jonathan's, record the day that the table came in. So if you can fuse those dots together, you should see a 3D image, which is actually a view from within the garage at the side of the building of these people delivering a 6-ton metal slab into the building. And that was our main table. And it was very heavy, obviously. They said they brought a crane that was rigged to do 6 tons, and it was starting to bend. In the foreground, you can see the air lorry isolators that we used to float the table. And that's the studio, Jonathan, artistically out of focus at the side there. We're using an Innova laser, which you can just see at the back. Large collimating mirror. Edwina's plate holder in the middle. That's a pretty good summary of the equipment we are using. And one of the first holograms we reshot was the Piero. This time I took away the ball because it seemed like a big black blob and nobody could focus on it, and gave him steel rings, which are actually a child's bangle. And the innovation here was that we used silver halide plates to make the H2 master, because we'd figured out that although photoresist was probably the ideal material, we were no way going to raise the sort of money that Pat Center obviously had got hold of to build their lab. And we wanted to do it with relatively low power lasers and on the cheap, if we could. And this is really a story about the success of that technique for at least 5 years. We made commercial holograms for lots of different clients. Here's one for Ford, where the image was larger than the standard 6x6 that the industry was offering. And the industry at that moment in time consisted of about half a dozen embossed holograms. Steve McGrew's company was the only place on the planet you could buy embossed holograms until we started up. There was a parallel move with Lawrence and the lab in Loughborough, and they actually beat us to getting the first commercial job, which was the UB40 album cover. And bizarrely, just as I was finishing this paper, I gave Lawrence a call and emailed a copy of it to him so that he could look for typos and see what we were doing. He said, "Oh, you're doing the same thing, were you?" And it turns out that they were also using silver halide initially to do their mastering. So the very first hologram, in that case, the very first commercially used hologram, embossed hologram outside the US of A was also mastered on halide emulsion. And of course, they were bigger. We were able to use 6 up to 10 inches. And so this Ford car is actually 4 inches by 8 inch plate. And we did a number of other commissioned work, for example, for other hologram companies. This one for Holo GmbH was from a Pulse Master, the H1. The model was too fragile, beautiful, delicate model that they provided us with. We couldn't shoot it with a continuous wave, so it was done with a pulse laser with John Webster. And I think that was probably one of the first, if not the first, hologram to be mastered using a pulse, apart from the Topan, was it? Light bulb. We saw 2D, 3D, and we very quickly did our own. We saw ET, and we, within weeks, or if not days, we were churning out 5-color 2D, 3Ds, or multi-level. The 25 there is actually a 3D hologram with stacked moiré in the background. Our biggest commission was, without doubt, American Greetings. It was a series of 58 different images. Unfortunately for Graham, the person commissioning it was Graham Ridout, which led to a litigation. That's all part of the history. We did 3D dual channels, and we even tried optical recombining by using coins and bits of shim to align the plate. As the time progressed, we were suckered into doing security work, and C3 was probably doing more security work than anything else by the time that Nigel left to join Applied. One of the things that we did, which was complete first, was to get silver records in vinyl. It wasn't the first time that it had been done in a record in black vinyl. Mike Foster had put grating images, but by putting a label on the press at the moment of impact, or just before the moment of impact, we were able to get the music and the hologram in the same moment of stamping. And basically all the details are in the paper, so I won't go into the myopics of the size of plates and the beam ratios and things, but I've put it all in there. The main innovation was the chemistry. I still had a library card to Cambridge University Library, so I could look at all the Russian papers, which the Americans had slavishly translated. And Nigel had independently done a lot of research. And so I think probably the chemistry was as good as it could be. We didn't just keep it locked down. We were continually trying to get it bigger and brighter. These are things we used for most of the time that we were in business. All the details are in the paper. The key was making an H3, because we found by trying with the ship hologram that if you you tried to vacuum metallize emulsion, it just sort of orange peeled and went incredibly dim. So you had to make an intermediate, and we used a visible light curing resin rather than a two-part resin. The problem with two-part resins, as you mix them together, you get air bubbles. It's almost inevitable. And some of those air bubbles are so small you don't notice them, but they'll end up being pinholes in the final shim, little black voids, which when you see it in the shim, you would certainly notice it. So we were keen to use something that was a single solution, keen not to flood the place with UV. So we eventually came across a solution which was provided by Scott Bader, which was a visible light cure single resin, and a bank of spotlights, basically, was illuminating a disc, which was a 14-inch disc standard size used in the record industry, but as a perspex disc instead of glass. And it was my job to cast these things and expose them and clean them up before we sent them to Inco for electroforming. which gave us a huge 14-inch size metal master. We were keen to keep what we were doing secret, so most of the time we kept ourselves to 6x6 because we figured it'd be obvious if we used the full 10 inches that we weren't using photoresist. And although the brightness was good, the clarity was good, it probably would never be exactly as good as the good saturation and quality that you can get from photoresist, which is why I say this is good for artists who might not have a choice but to use low-cost materials. It does give you an avenue for using red laser instead of expensive blue or green ones, and it gives you the chance to either make limited editions of castings or limited editions of shims. So the longevity of a nickel plate is obviously much, much greater than any emulsion-based plate, and one could make a single complicated piece which you then get an electroformer to run 50 copies of. And I think that this is an opportunity which, as far as I know, with the exception of Harriet, who did a shim edition, and I hear Paul is thinking of doing a shim edition, it hasn't been greatly used, and I think it could be in the future much better used to use silver halide relief holograms to make limited editions. So that's the conclusion, really, that we were in business through to 1989. I did, in the end, turn to photoresist and gave up on silver halide, and I think Nigel, when he was at Applied, struggled for a bit to continue using the system we were using before deciding that photoresist was the way to go. But these days, people who are shooting photoresist are doing smaller and smaller images for security. The 6x6 standard has now come down to sort of, 3x3 as a large image these days. And so it's a very different world. If this was to gain a revival by using the Fuji materials, I think it could again have a new promise. And that's why I'm boring you with this paper today, because I could see no point in providing this information when there wasn't an emulsion to use, when Agfa wasn't supplying. And that's it, really. Thank you.
Thank you very much, David. Okay, any questions there?
Hi, Jeff Odner. Did you ever measure how small the structures could be compared to photoresist, or just how small the structures were, or what they looked like, whether it was sinusoidal or whether you had sharp sides, the aspect angles, or put it under a SEM or something like that?
Yes, we it's quite expensive to do SEMs of work, but we did get some done, especially in the early days, to see which direction we should be going with the chemistry. I think our feelings were that the result by eye in the embossed piece was what counted, that it was our goal to produce something of a commercial standard that was as close to photoresist or better. I mean, there's some bad holograms shot in photoresist. We were continually trying to get up to the bar, the standard was coming out of Light Impressions from California at the time. So, if you like, what our studies were concerned with was what it looked like in the embossed, as opposed to a scientific analysis. We did some of that, but it was less interesting to know what shape it was if it was dim than to get one that was bright.
I take it your H3 was a Contech print into photoresist, is that correct?
No, it was a cast resin. And The Scott Bader product that we're using isn't probably available these days, but I was speaking to Craig, and he was assuring me that there's a lot of UV resins in the years since we sold C3. Probably that side of the technology has improved, and I haven't even looked at it. But you need just something which will do two things. One, it'll intimately take up the profile of the hologram, and two, it'll survive being electroformed. So as long as it meets those two criteria, you can use any.
Did you ever consider making your H2 directly in photoresist?
Yes, that's what we then turned our lives to doing. But only once you've got a budget to buy a much more expensive lab than perhaps most artists could afford.
How many strengths can you get? Was it pretty comparable to the regular plastic shim?
Can you say that again?
You know, your plastic shims, your cast resin shims.
They were used once. They were sent for electroforming, and then we'd work off the grandfather. Yes.
So
The process that we were using, I had to clean them up at the edges. If I wanted to make an addition and then get them sort of vacuum coated with aluminium, I think that would have been perfectly doable. The ones that I've still got haven't degraded as far as I can tell. There would be an upper limit to how many pulls you could get. But probably it would be because you broke the plate or scratched it or something, as opposed to... Yeah.
Silicon mold-making compound is pretty... Industrial
supply works very... Silicon mold, would that survive electroforming?
No, but if you want to...
This doesn't... I mean, is this working?
Not that I can tell.
Okay, anyway, the silicon mold-making material...
Yes.
That works too. If you want to pull multiples off the gelatin.
And would that survive a vacuum coating with aluminum?
You would then use that to pull the resin copies off.
Okay.
And I've used a number of them that work just fine. A number of molding. The ones, there's a popular in the States, there's a McMaster Car. They have a unbranded material that's kind of blue in color, and it's relatively inexpensive. And it works fine.
And that, is that liquid when it's...
It's liquid.
Mm-hmm.
You need a vacuum pump and a chamber to pull.
A vacuum frame. Right. I think the beauty... If I was going to research this further, I'd be looking for a resin which you could pour on under glass and then... expose ideally in sunlight. Scott Bader told us that there was a catalytic solution we could use to accelerate the process, but because we didn't want a two-part solution, we never used it. I just leave the things to cure with white light for an hour.
Mm-hmm.
But that would be a white relief hologram.
Mm-hmm.
Right. Right. In silicon. Yes. I'm throwing this to you to then come back next time and tell me what's good with the Fuji emulsions and what UV curing or other resins or compounds are good to make the H3. So I want feedback.
Great.
Thank you.